Crucifixion. There was an upper room where Jesus and the disciples met to have what's known as the Last Supper. And Jesus made it very clear to them that he wanted them to continue to do that in a manner that would glorify him, but the key thing he said about it was remember. Easter Sunday, we were sharing memories a while ago. There's all kinds of things to remember. So right now, we're going to share, as Jesus said, take this cup, take this bread, and eat it in remembrance until I come. So, Brother Garland, would you come? And Brother David, would you lead us in a prayer before we pass the cup?
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the day. We thank you for the music we've listened to. And Father, Thank you for the mercy you sent. We just pray that you let it come some more. Just glad that everybody thirsty. Lord, we thank you for Jesus and what he did for our lives, and what he means to each one of us. We thank you for his death and his resurrection. Father, we just ask that you be with each one of us as we go throughout this week, and we might be remembering, like the pastor said, just the remembrance of Christ and what he did. And we thank you, Father, for your love for us. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Took the cup and he passed it around as well and said, this, I want you to remember the blood that I shed for you as you drink the fruit of the vine. Said they sang a hymn and went out. Casey's gonna sing a hymn for us. No. My bad. my plan, and I was circumnavigating. Because you're not escaping without me preaching, right? Gonna do a little different today. I've got three different segments of the same message. The message is pretty simple and straightforward, because those of us that are Christians and have been for a long time have celebrated this day over and over again, many years, some of us. And as I was trying to figure out what to preach, and I don't usually preach on Easter. I preach on that day, but I don't preach about the subject typically. I kind of dove into it this year in a way I never had before. And for me to get back to you all that I've learned, we would need a week. But there was three important questions that came up. A lot of people are still asking them. And the first question is, nobody in this room is asking this question, right? And I understand that. But this question is addressed to a lot of pastors and preachers and other Christians as to, and I wouldn't yet say that it's pretty well accepted worldwide that we celebrate Easter because Jesus is risen from the grave. But there's one thing: in order to rise from the grave, the first thing that has to happen is you have to be dead. A lot of people still believe that Jesus didn't die, that he fainted, or he was so overwhelmed with physical, the nuances of the beating and the crucifixion that he just lost consciousness. That is a lie.
Amen.
It's called the swoon theory by some. But I bring it up because people really ask the question, did Jesus die? Well, let me tell you, there's unequivocal proof that Jesus died. There were some real simple things that happened, and there were some that were a little bit more complex and take a little reasoning, but by the same token, let's talk about the beating. The first thing that happened was the beating, and they jammed the crown of thorns down in his head, and his head began to bleed. But the beating, the Roman beating, was done by a cat of nine tails. That is nine different leather straps with embedded metals and bone stuck in the tips. Can you imagine that being across a man's back? That picture that we saw a moment ago wasn't near enough blood on Jesus. The back of Jesus, well, the Roman beating happened a lot, and the typical plan was 39 stripes. It's actually 40 save one, because if they went past 40, the person giving the beating would be penalized. But I think a lot of people turn their heads sometimes. Many people died just from the beating. I read several descriptions. One of them was that probably a part of his entrails were even showing through his back because the cuts are so deep and there's so many. I know this is gruesome, but it's the reality of what happened to Jesus.
Amen.
One person that I heard and read about said, you could not have placed your finger anywhere on Jesus' back that it did not fall into a deep gash. Many people died just from the beating alone. Then they had him pick up his cross, which was probably just a part across the top, not a part you would drag the whole thing behind you, typically. So he was already exhausted and emaciated from the beating. One thing to pause and think about, if he could even still walk and pick up the cross, I'm thinking Jesus was a man's man.
Amen.
Not just some little weak, what's the word, milquetoast sort of guy. We know him dreams, carpenter. So we know he knew how to use his hands, and we knew that it took strength to make all of those pieces of furniture that he learned from his father, earthly father. Then there's the crucifixion. There's another thing wrong with the picture. I don't know if you noticed, and noticed that the nails were here. If you think about it logically, that could not possibly work. Because there's no bone structure across here, and it would just rip out from the weight of the person. They ran it through here, and if you think about it, if you go into other languages and examine their definition of the word hand, it always includes the wrist. So the nails were driven here and here. And I saw an interesting thing yesterday that I think I'd seen that episode before. It was Josh Gates and his, what is it?
Expedition
Unknown. And he does a lot of things overseas and goes into ancient structures and underground and all of that. But anyway, he was actually shown a piece of bone. It was a piece of an ankle bone that still had a part of the nail in it that had been dug up in some excavation. Kind of verifies that concept of, because if you think about it, there has to be some structure to bear the weight. Well, there you go. You've got the weight of the person, right? You're out like this. And in order to keep on breathing, they would have to push up in order to release the pressure so that they could exhale. Inhaling was not a problem, but exhaling, they couldn't do it. Can you imagine? In the hot sun, in the desert, then the tradition was, well, if they didn't want, especially because it was the Jewish culture, they didn't want anybody to be on the cross in the Sabbath, on the Sabbath day. And as the sun was beginning to go down, they would break their legs so that they could no longer stand up and exhale, and so they would suffocate. That didn't happen to Jesus. Because the Bible predicts long before that there will never be a bone broken in his body. So if you ever wondered why the soldier took the spear and ran it up under his rib cage into his heart and lungs, that's why there was water from the lungs and blood from the heart coming out. Probably a lot more water than blood, but you know, Jesus died. The soldier pronounced him dead. I love also what he said. He said, surely this man is the Son of God. Surely this man is the Son of God. So absolutely, yes. Jesus died. He died on the cross. One of our favorite phrases, he died on the cross for you and me. Why? Because you and I, as sinners, have a sin debt that needs to be paid. And Jesus paid it. Jesus paid it. One of my favorite hymns we sing is that old song, Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but he washed me white as snow. So, Jesus died, but there's more to come later. Let's sing, Casey. This is your part of the sermon to preach, okay?
Let's all stand. Just for a bit. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. Jesus lives today.
day will come when you all will see. 'Cause I'll rise again. There's no power on earth that can tie me down. Yes, I'll rise again. Death can't keep me in the ground.
That's it. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Number two. Question number two.
Does the tomb remain empty?
I'm not saying it. Yeah. Yes, the tomb was empty. The reason we know is that several people encountered the empty tomb. Mary went, remember? Mary Magdalene and the other Mary. And one of the references said there was other women. Then when she ran back to tell the disciples, Peter and John took off running. I guess John was the track star. He won because he got there first. They both looked in. And they said, cloth was folded. And nobody was there. And then there was an angel that said, why are you looking for the living among the dead? The tomb was a big stone opening. There was a gigantic wall. How did it happen? Well, you heard saw the video a while ago with the kids. It was an earthquake. But the bottom line is, Jesus kept telling the disciples, this is the way it's going to happen. They're going to kill me. And I'm going to rise on the third day. Now, once they saw Jesus hanging on the cross, they were devastated. They were lost in their own maze of complete disillusionment. They saw the tomb empty, but they hadn't seen him face to face yet. So they weren't even sure. In fact, remember, Mary commented to Jesus himself, saying, thinking he was the gardener. If you've taken him somewhere, tell me where so I can go and take care of him. A lot of confusion going on. But there was no question. We have eyewitness accounts. Multiple accounts. We'll talk about that in a little bit. Of the fact that Jesus' tomb was empty, and it was borrowed at that. We call it Jesus' tomb, but it belonged to another man who loaned it to him. Maybe Joseph of Arimathea already knew he's not going to need it very long. Casey, let's sing.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus, he came to love, heal and forgive, he lived and died, to buy my pardon, and an empty grave.
Sing it out now.
Because he
We've been celebrating Easter for a long, long time. Celebrating the resurrection of the Savior of the world. And you might believe that he's the Savior of the world, but let me point one more thing out. Believing he's the Savior of the world will not allow you to be with him in heaven.
Amen.
You must believe it for yourself and trust in him and rely only on him for that same transaction of the payment for your sins. Well, if we're going to prove something in a courtroom, it's very customary to have witnesses. And this is where the resurrection of Jesus really shines. I mean, there were witnesses all along. They witnessed his beating. They witnessed his death on the cross. They witnessed the empty tomb. Eyewitnesses. Well, we've already talked about Mary. There was the 12, well, the 11. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15 that he actually saw the risen Christ and that he is also an apostle, like the 12. And then in that same passage, Paul mentions 500 other people. Now, if you're in a debate with somebody, there's less evidence for the 500 people, but this one reference here that Paul gives is full of great creed, because he actually got the information in that passage, 15:1-4. It's actually considered to be the creed of the earthly church because of the way he wrote it out in words that connoted the fact that he was quoting eyewitnesses and even mentions Peter and James in that particular. There's a lot of controversy over that being the creed of the early church, but we know Paul wrote that in 55 AD or 51 AD, and that he had already distributed that among the Corinthian people as a creed to live by, to go by. And we know that the information came from probably within a year after Jesus' death. You remember when Peter went back to Jerusalem to confront Peter, really? Did I say Peter? Paul went back to Jerusalem to confront Peter on one issue. There's evidence because he uses a word in that particular Corinthian passage about history. And he had gone back with a great inquiring mind, and he picked the brains of all the disciples while he was there, because he wanted to know all of the things that they had experienced walking daily with the Son of God. And on top of that, we don't have any trouble, us folks in this room don't have any trouble believing that the Bible is the Word of God. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
There's plenty of biblical evidence. I'm going to mention 7 or 8 scriptures. You might want to jot these down. But Jesus' appearances before people, and I'm not even going to include the 500 group in this particular, but there's a scripture reference for every one of these. There was Mary Magdalene, John 20:10-18. It was the other women, Matthew 28:8-10. Remember Cleopas and The other disciple, we don't know by name, but they were other apostles. They were walking on the road to Emmaus, and Jesus appeared to them, had conversation with them. And it wasn't till later that they realized it was the Lord. Even spent the night in the same place. Then he appeared to 10 disciples and others. Thomas was absent on this one, John 20:19-23. But he appeared. And remember this? Remember? At the Sea of Galilee, they came in from fishing. This is the second draft of fish. And Jesus was standing on the seashore. My southern mind says he had the frying pan going. Had fish laying out there, probably were on a spit. But they ate with him. They touched him. His physical body. We know it was glorified at this point, but so Thomas and the other disciples he appeared to in John 20:26-32, and then seven disciples in John 21:1-14. And then all the disciples were gathered around in Matthew 28, verses 16-20, which we quote often, where Jesus said, go, teach, preach. Teach them to observe whatever I have commanded you, and be baptized. Be baptized. And then there was the Mount of Olives, where he ascended. Luke 24:50-52, and Acts 1:4-9. Plenty of biblical references. And here's the thing that really clinches it for me in the modern day world. I've read through so many scholar interpretations of all of these details, and they go into detail that my little brain never would have even thought about. It was fascinating reading. But one of the things that struck me the most, and this was in the 1800s, okay? One of the founders of the Harvard Law School, Christopher Greenleaf, he's a man I know. Simon Greenleaf. He said it upon himself to disprove that the resurrection of Jesus Christ did not happen, could not have happened. It goes against all human logic. Well, that's the idea.
Amen.
The whole idea of salvation by the grace of God, not earning something. In our world, you get it, you earn it. But the gift of salvation is free from Jesus.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
But Christopher Greenleaf said, this isn't a quote, this is my version of what he said, because what he said was this long. That the resurrection of Jesus Christ stands proven fact in the courtroom. Mm-hmm. Because there's so many witnesses, if nothing else. And the witnesses are reliable. The scriptures reliable, he says. And his goal was to disprove it. I don't want to leave you with one other quote. This is an exact quote. I had to buy reading glasses this week, so. Bet he got that big enough for sure. You'll notice this name is familiar, but I'm not going to say it till the end. I know the resurrection is a fact, and Watergate proved it to me. How? Because 12 men testified that they had seen Jesus raised from the dead. Then they proclaimed that truth for 40 years, never once denying it. Everyone was beaten, tortured, stoned, and put in prison. Watergate embroiled 12 of the most powerful men in the world. Let that soak in for a second. Dash. And they couldn't keep alive for 3 weeks. You're telling me that 12 apostles could keep alive for 40 years? Absolutely. Impossible, he says. Chuck Colson.
Yep.
Who was saved through all of that mess. And spent the rest of his life going to prisons and telling people about Jesus. That's how much he believed it. I know we believe it. But I like to hear somebody else's opinion. These people, I was reading a lot smarter than me. I couldn't even think of the questions they were asking people. But the point of it is, Jesus is alive. You know, we talk about relationships in our world today. There's a lot of relationships. That word's used a lot for a lot of different situations. But as I said last Sunday, you cannot have a relationship with someone who is dead. There's one major requirement for a relationship. In the present tense, the person has to be alive. Jesus said, I'll be with you always.
Amen.
Even unto the end of the world. Betty and I want to share a song to close out that's so very appropriate for this day, because it's about Jesus. Someday I'm going to figure out how to keep my computer from going to sleep.
She messed it up.
Breath. The crowd that cried, Hosanna, now shouted for his death. Condemned and rejected, deserted and left to die. The soldiers mocked the sinless man. And God cried. And
against a black sky, and there upon his shoulders the sins of man would ride. Please, Father, don't forsake me. And God cried. And God cried.
One final cry of anguish. Salvation's price was paid.
A massive stone now sealed the tomb, the place where Christ was laid.
3 days in the darkness, it seemed that love had died.
And death had won its victory.
And God cried. The grave did not contain him. No soul could hope to hide. And God cried, Jesus is alive. The Son of God is risen. Death is crucified. The grave did not contain him. No soul could hope to hide. Is alive. The Son of God is risen. Death is crucified. The grave could not contain him. No stone could hold to hide. God cried. God cried.
And God cried.
Father, thank you so much that we know for a fact that Jesus is alive. Thank you for bringing him to this earth and letting him walk and talk with humans like us, and that they could watch him die and then watch him be raised from the grave to prove that everything that he said about himself was true. Lord, as we depart from this place, I pray that on the uppermost parts of our mind and lives, that we would live out the reality of the resurrection of Jesus, because he's alive. Jesus, it's in your mighty, magnificent, strong, stupendous, awesome name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You're dismissed.